Lupin Pharmaceuticals in association with Higher Secondary Principals Forum.
A very warm welcome to you all. I am Fesal Fernandes, political science teacher from Santacruz Higher Secondary. I am very privileged that I can reach out to you all through this series of Prudent Scholars in this time, especially when we are all being homebound. I am here to give you a lesson today on political science from your 12th standard syllabus from the book Contemporary World Politics. As I begin with my lesson, I want you all to have a look at this image. Well, I don't need to tell anyone what map is this, as we all know that this is the map of world. Well, this map, world map, is having a very well-defined continents here. We have the North America, we have the South America, we have Europe, Africa, Asia, Australia, and Antarctica. These are the seven continents which are very well defined on this map. Now I want you to think, which continent does India belong to? Yes, I'm sure you all know by now that India belongs to this continent, that is Asia. So, in this lesson today, we are going to study about this continent. We are going to study about India. We are going to study about a few more countries from Asia. Now, the next question that may come to your mind, are we going to study everything about Asia and everything about all the Asian countries? Well, not really. If you look at this map, there are a few countries which are marked around Indian border. We have India, we have Pakistan, Nepal, Bhutan. Then towards the south, we have the oceans. We have Bay of Bengal, Indian Ocean, Arabian Sea, we have Maldives, we have Sri Lanka. Well, yes, we are going to study in Asia about these few countries with whom India is sharing its borders. And now, the only Asian countries with which India is sharing the borders is the South Asian countries. We have these South Asian countries which we are going to study today in today's lesson. So the lesson title is Contemporary South Asia. So this is the fifth chapter from your book, that is Contemporary World Politics in 12th Standard Syllabus for Political Science. As I begin with the lesson, the very first thing that will come to your mind, what is South Asia? Well, it isn't very difficult to understand if you look at this image. In this image, only the area which is shaded in green, okay? So these countries which are shaded in green are considered as South Asian countries. This will help you to understand a little better where exactly in the world are the South Asian countries and which is the composition of the South Asian countries. So I hope I'm very clear with explaining what is South Asia. Now, let us move on to the next thing. If we are studying about South Asia, which are the exact South Asian countries we are going to study? Well, we are going to study about seven South Asian countries. The seven South Asian countries that we are going to study in this chapter are Bangladesh, Pakistan, India. Then we have Sri Lanka, Bhutan, Maldives, and Nepal. So again, let me say, we have Bangladesh, we have Pakistan, India, we have Sri Lanka, we have Maldives, we have Bhutan, and we have Nepal. So these are the seven South Asian countries that we are going to study in this chapter. Well, you may again think, are we going to study everything about these South Asian countries? Not really. We are going to study just a few aspects of these countries. The very first thing that will help you to understand these countries a little more better is if we know the geography of these areas. If we go to see the geography of this area, the South Asian countries are very well demarcated with natural boundaries. We have towards the north, we have the mighty Himalayas. Okay, so these demarcate the natural boundaries of the South Asian countries. Then towards the south, as you can see, we have the oceans. We have the Indian Ocean, we have the Bay of Bengal, which demarcates the borders for the South Asian countries. Okay, so the South Asian countries have natural bordering for these areas. Towards the north there are Himalayas, whereas towards the south there is the ocean. Now in this image you will see there is Pakistan, India, Nepal, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Bhutan, Maldives. Whereas there is also another country, there is Afghanistan there. Now you may think, why didn't I say about Afghanistan anything? Is it not a part of South Asia? Well, yes, it is not considered as a part of South Asia because the politics of Afghanistan is studied in the Middle East countries. That's why it is not considered as a part of South Asia. When we look at the nations here, if you see the countries, the largest country over here among the South Asian countries is India. So India is physically quite dominating when it comes to the entire South Asian nations. So India is physically a bigger nation when it comes to the South Asian countries and in a better position with all the other countries because it shares its borders with most of the South Asian countries. So I hope with this at least the geography of South Asian countries is clear. So again, we are going to study about these South Asian countries, that is Pakistan, India, Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Maldives. Okay, so the seven South Asian countries and geography. As we are done with the geography, let's move on to the next thing. In contemporary South Asia, the one aspect that we are going to study about these nations and about these countries is political aspect. That is, what kind of political system did these countries have? Whether they had political system which was a really good in favor at that time. So what was the kind of political system that they had? Whether they had a dictatorship or whether they had democracy. When we talk about these two political systems in the South Asian countries, whether if they followed a dictatorship or they followed democracy. Now the next thing I want to ask you, can you think of what is exactly dictatorship and what is democracy? They are the two different areas of politics. Contradicting areas of politics, you can see. Dictatorship, as you can see in the image, it's a one-man rule wherein one person rules over the others. Whereas democracy, we are all quite familiar, even in school, we are quite familiar with democracy. With one very simple thing of understanding, we all say democracy is of the people, for the people and by the people. So a government or a kind of a political system wherein people are given more importance than one person. So it's a government that is formed by the people and it's a government that is for the people. So entirely wherein people have a more to say, to do, rather than one person doing for everyone. So in this lesson in contemporary South Asia, we are going to see about the political systems of these seven countries, whether these seven countries have had democracy or whether these seven countries have had dictatorship. The seven countries that we have in South Asia, as I have said earlier, that is Bangladesh, Pakistan, India, Sri Lanka, Bhutan, Maldives and Nepal. When we talk about Bangladesh and Pakistan, when we talk about these two countries, these countries have had dictatorship as well as democracy. When we talk about India and Sri Lanka, India and Sri Lanka are such countries which have actually maintained democratic form of government after their independence. After the independence, both India as well as Sri Lanka have started in fact with democracy and have continued with democracy till date. Both India and Sri Lanka also have another common thing, that is both were ruled by British. The next three countries, that is Bhutan, Maldives and Nepal, these are the countries which were ruled by a monarch. Now a monarch is a king, so these were ruled by a monarch and then later they shifted to constitutional monarchy and then even later now democracy. So different countries started with different form of governments and then now moved on to a path of democracy. So is democracy having in South Asian countries that easy, or were the South Asian countries all the time demanding democracy? But if we look at the overall seven countries, it is much easier to understand that there is democracy in a favorable form of a government in these countries. Let us move on to the next thing, that is military and democracy in Pakistan. We'll take individual countries to understand how they have had democracy and dictatorship, or dictatorship and democracy. When we look into this map, I want you to see and focus on three things in this map of India. We have Pakistan, which is this part. We have India and this small stretch, which is marked there as East Pakistan. This is at the time of independence. Now, India got its independence in the year 1947, whereas Pakistan also got its independence in the same year, more or less on the same day, just one day before they are celebrating their Independence Day. So at the time of independence, India, Pakistan was divided into two parts. We all know that very clear, that there was a division of India. There was a two nations theory that was proposed to divide India and Pakistan at the time of independence. But if I have to say, we have to say India was divided although into two nations, but was divided into three parts, because in the same time Pakistan and this part of Pakistan, okay, was also created at the time of 1947. This is actually Bengal, which was divided and was formed as Pakistan. So part of Pakistan was over here, whereas the other Pakistan was over here, which is quite far from the other one. So this side of Pakistan was considered as West Pakistan, whereas this side of Pakistan was considered as East Pakistan. So the West Pakistan and the East Pakistan was created in the year 1947. So when this West Pakistan and East Pakistan was created, as we can see, the West Pakistan is actually a larger dominant area compared to the East. So when the actual system of administration began, there was a lot of problem between the West Pakistan and the East Pakistan. The West Pakistan was all the time dominating over the East Pakistan. Whether it is culture, whether it is politics, whether it is language, whether it is religion, was dominated over to East Pakistan. This was not liked by East Pakistan, and there was a constant struggle between East Pakistan and West Pakistan at this time. So in the year 1970, there were elections which were held, and in these elections Sheikh Mujibur Rahman won the elections, and Sheikh Mujibur Rahman belonged to the eastern part of Pakistan. So when Sheikh Mujibur Rahman won the elections, they had to form a government, and East Pakistan forming a government and dominating over the West Pakistan was not acceptable to West Pakistan, and hence at this time there was a killing ordered in East Pakistan. Due to this chaos in East Pakistan, the thing that actually took place was the only rescue for the people in East Pakistan was the closer nation to move out. So, and I don't need to tell you which is the closer nation wherein they could easily go. That is India. Hence, they moved on to the eastern part of India. There were lots of people, there were thousands of people who migrated from East Pakistan to India at this time as refugees. They came to India as refugees from East Pakistan in the year 1971. So when these refugees from East Pakistan came to India, India could not say no, because according to the international law of refugees, I hope you know what's the meaning of refugee. Refugees are people who leave their country in terms of emergency. This emergency could be natural calamity, it could be a war, it could be a famine. So at this time there were killings ordered, and to save their life in East Pakistan, people came to India. So India had to shelter thousands of people from East Pakistan to India, which was again a great problem for India, because India also had to go through population pressure, land pressure at this time. So when India sheltered these people from East Pakistan, it came into the eye of Pakistan that India is supporting East Pakistan to fight against West Pakistan. I hope I am clear with what I am saying. When East Pakistan people entered into India, Pakistan, that is West Pakistan, felt that India was supporting the East Pakistan people to fight against the West Pakistan. The result was India had to face a war with Pakistan in the year 1971. With the end of the war, there was a ceasefire, and with the end of the war in 1971, Bangladesh was created from East Pakistan. So the East Pakistan, which was a part of Pakistan, was given its independence and was completely a new country, which was termed as Bangladesh. So Bangladesh got its independence in the year 1971. So with this we got these three countries, that is Pakistan, India and Bangladesh, by 1971. And ever since then, Bangladesh has been trying to have democratic form of government. India, we don't need to tell that India since 1947 have had a democratic form of government and is been following democracy even now. Okay, now let us have a look at the form of government in Pakistan, or the political system in Pakistan, military or democracy. In the year 1958, it was General Ayub Khan who had taken over the administration of Pakistan. And General Ayub Khan was a military ruler, and hence this time in the year 1958, it is a dictatorship. I have mentioned it earlier also, dictatorship is one person ruling over the people. So because General Ayub Khan's was a dictatorship, and the other thing was, people were dissatisfied. People were not very happy with the rule of General Ayub Khan. So there was a popular dissatisfaction among the people. Because of this dissatisfaction among the people, General Yahya Khan took over again as a military ruler. General Yahya Khan was also a dictator. So when it comes to Pakistan, we have General Ayub Khan in the year 1958, and we have General Yahya Khan who had taken over after General Ayub Khan. So both these leaders were dictators. Definitely by now during Yahya Khan's rule, there were two crises that Pakistan had faced. The Bangladesh crisis, which I have just spoken in the previous slide, how Bangladesh was created from Pakistan, that is from East Pakistan, it became Bangladesh. And the second one was a war with India. So there were two crises that Pakistan faced during General Yahya Khan's rule. So as a result, the next person to come up in Pakistan as a leader was Zulfikar Ali Bhutto. This time the Bhutto government was a democratic form of government. Zulfikar Ali Bhutto was the founder of the Pakistan's People's Party. He was an advocate by profession and he was a democratic person. So his power or his leadership went in for Pakistan from 1971 to 77. There was a coup that was planned against him and Zulfikar Ali Bhutto was brought down and removed from the post of the leadership of Pakistan. And a new government of Zia-ul-Haq was established. This time Zia-ul-Haq's government was a dictatorship. So if we have a look, we have military, that is dictatorship during Ayub Khan. Then we have Yahya Khan, again the military rule, dictatorship. Then we have Zulfikar Ali Bhutto, who was a Democrat, who established a democratic form of a government in Pakistan. And then Zia-ul-Haq, who was again a dictator in Pakistan. Then, the next ruler, okay, again after Zia-ul-Haq was Benazir Bhutto. Now, Benazir Bhutto is daughter of Zulfikar Ali Bhutto. During the time of Zia-ul-Haq, people were completely dissatisfied. Also, there was a pro-democratic movement that was taking place. Because by now, during the time of Zulfikar Ali Bhutto, people had already tasted what is democracy. So, they were fighting. They were people who were fighting for democracy. So, now, next we had Benazir Bhutto. So, the phase of democracy from Zulfikar Ali Bhutto then came to dictatorship to Zia-ul-Haq and then went on to Benazir Bhutto. And after Benazir Bhutto, the democratic phase came to an end for some time until Parvez Musharraf took over as a dictator of Pakistan. So, if we look into the political history of Pakistan, we have dictatorship, then we have democracy, then again there was dictatorship, again there was democracy, and then again there was dictatorship. So, there it looks like people were demanding for democracy, they were getting democracy, but there were a few factors that were leading dictatorship not to succeed and in fact were leading dictatorship. So, the factors that contributed to the failure of democracy in Pakistan, what were the factors? As just in the previous slide, we have seen that there were democracy which was been demanded by the people, but then again after due to some reasons, dictatorship came into existence. Now, what are the factors that is making democracy a failure in Pakistan? Well, the social dominance in military and the clergy or the aristocrats. You know, every society have some sections which are dominant in the society. So, here also the dominant sections in the society like the military, the aristocrats, the clergy never wanted to have democracy because it is during dictatorship rule they were having a better hand in the government than the democratic, because we all know democracy is for the people, of the people and by the people, as we are used to say it. Okay, so democracy will give more power into the hands of the people and the aristocrats and the clergy and the military will not get much of the power in their hand. Hence, they were not supporting democracy and every time there would be democracy, they would see to it that democracy is brought down and dictatorship is coming back again. The other thing is, there were some pro-military groups in Pakistan which were very active. You know, pro-military groups are those dictatorship or those groups which were all the time for dictatorship. The reason was Pakistan and India had many issues. One of the biggest issues that is unresolved even till now is Jammu and Kashmir. So due to this, there have been issues and wars with between India and Pakistan. So the pro-military groups would become more powerful during this time. The next thing that why dictatorship would be more successful in Pakistan is the lack of genuine support. There would be no genuine support in Pakistan for democracy, and hence dictatorship would all the time come up in Pakistan. Also, another reason why there is a failure of democracy was United States and other Western countries were not much encouraging democracy, but were most of the time into military support. So most of the time they were authoritarian supporters, and hence democracy was at international level in Pakistan also was not getting much of the support, and hence democracy in Pakistan was not becoming a success and would become a failure. Now let us move on to the next. Contemporary South Asia. Right now we have done these countries' politics, that is Bangladesh, Pakistan, India. We know that India is having democratic form of government since independence. We know Bangladesh, how Bangladesh was created, and since then it started having democracy. Bangladesh created from Pakistan. The next we have done also about Pakistan, whether Pakistan had dictatorship or democracy, the struggle you can say between democracy, the struggle for democracy to come up in Pakistan in fact. Now let us move on to the next country in South Asia, that is Sri Lanka. So have a look at this map of Sri Lanka. This is a very small country towards the south of India. If you look at this map, it will exactly tell you where Sri Lanka falls in the whole of world map, and it's a very close neighbor to India, and in fact it doesn't have closer neighbor than India. Okay, so Sri Lanka and India. When we talk about Sri Lanka and India, both had a British rule over it. So India got its independence in the year 1947 and Sri Lanka got its independence in the year 1948. From the British rule, when Sri Lanka got its independence, the transfer of power was very peaceful. We do not have, the way we had in India, sacrifices, the way India, there was a two nations theory that was proposed and passed, and the way things happened at the time of independence did not take place at the time of independence in Sri Lanka. It was a very peaceful transfer of power from British to Sri Lankan government in the year 1947. After the independence, Sri Lanka started having a democratic form of government. It started with a democratic form of government, and the people of Sri Lanka living in Sri Lanka are called as Sinhalas. The way people living in India are called as Indians, America are called as Americans. Similarly, people living in Sri Lanka are called as Sinhalans. The politics in Sri Lanka was dominated by these Sinhalans. There is another aspect. When we talk about the aspect or political aspect of Sri Lanka, we do not have much to discuss about democracy or dictatorship because it has been democracy throughout. But the another aspect in Sri Lanka is the Tamils. In Sri Lanka, we have the Tamils who have settled over here. You know, there were a lot of Tamils during the time of British rule who had gone and settled in Sri Lanka. In fact, they were taken as workers in their tea plantation in Sri Lanka in the 19th and the 20th century. When these Tamils went to Sri Lanka, settled there for so many years, now the Sinhala and started taking the benefits in Sri Lanka, it was quite natural. So the Sinhalas felt that Sri Lanka belongs to the Sinhalas and not the Tamils. So the Tamils should not be given any benefits. Due to the complete neglected feeling throughout in Sri Lanka, the Tamils in Sri Lanka formed the LTTE in the year 1983, that is Liberation Tigers of Tamil Illam, a militant group in the year 1983. When they formed a LTTE in the year 1983 in Sri Lanka, they started demanding a complete separate state for them within Sri Lanka, a complete separate state for the Tamils, which would look like this. More or less like this. The blue shade over here was an area that was not actually controlled, was claimed. So they wanted this area to be claimed as a complete separate place for the Tamils in Sri Lanka, which was not acceptable to the people in Sri Lanka. So there was a constant struggle going on between the Tamils and between the Sinhalas. The Indian government at this time was trying to negotiate with the government of Sri Lanka to deal with this. And in the year 1987, the Indian government sent the troops, IPKF, to Sri Lanka to deal with the Tamils in Sri Lanka and to stabilize the relationship between the Sinhalas and the Tamils. This gesture of India of sending the IPKF forces in Sri Lanka was not liked by the Sri Lankan government, as it was considered as Indian interfering into the political matters of Sri Lanka. It was seen, this gesture of India was seen as an interference by the Sri Lankan government. So in the year 1989, the IPKF was pulled out of Sri Lanka without attaining its objectives, because they got involved with the Tamils, into some fight with the Tamils in Sri Lanka, and hence they had to be pulled out. This ethnic conflict between the Sinhalas and the Tamils in Sri Lanka have been going on for decades. It went on for almost for three decades, and it is one of the longest civil war in the world, we can say. This ethnic conflict is one of the longest civil war between the Tamils and the Sri Lankan people, that is the Sinhalans. Let us move on to the next country in South Asia, that is Nepal. This is the map of Nepal. If you have a look at this, Nepal shares a majority of its border with India. So Nepal and India shares, just the way they share their borders, they also share very close relation with one another. When we talk about Nepal and their political system, Nepal was historically a Hindu kingdom in the past. Then later it was controlled by the monarch. Monarch is the king who controlled over the population and over the country. Okay, then the people in Nepal were later started demanding to have a democratic form of government. As we all know, the South Asian countries by 1950s, most of them were having a democratic form of a government. So people in Nepal were also aware that their neighboring countries are having a democratic form of a government, and hence there was a demand for a democratic form of a government in Nepal as well. But the monarch did not accept the demand and in fact suppressed the demand for a very long time. After a long struggle, somewhere in the year 1990, the monarch accepted a bit of people's demand and established some representative council, some representatives who have been elected by the people in Nepal, and established something called as constitutional monarchy, wherein there are the representatives and the monarch is still the head of the state. So there was some kind of democracy which was there in the hands of people. But this was not the end for Nepal. There was a struggle still going on, because there were the people who were demanding democracy. There was also a monarch who wanted to control in Nepal. There were also people who did not want monarchical rule at all. They were the Maoists. The Maoists, in fact, wanted to overthrow the monarch of Nepal completely and establish People's Republic, that is complete people's rule in Nepal. So it was a kind of a triangular struggle in Nepal between the Maoists, between the Democrats and between the Nepali people. So it was a kind of a triangular struggle for democracy in Nepal. As a result, because of this entire chaos and conflicts, monarch completely finished off with the representative, dissolved the representatives which was been appointed and established a monarchical rule all over again. By then people were not happy to have monarchical rule all over again, and there was a constant struggle demanding to have and restoring the representative house which was been dissolved by the monarch. After a long struggle by the people, the struggle between the Maoist for democracy, somewhere in the year 2007, there was an agreement by the monarch to give up his rule and establish a complete democracy in Nepal. So it was a long struggle for Nepal for democracy. So democracy in Nepal just did not come. It wasn't that easy to have democracy in Nepal. So in Nepal also, like the other countries, had to struggle for democracy. Let us move on to the next, that is Bhutan. This is the map of Bhutan. Just as I had shown you and said earlier that as Nepal shares its borders with India, Bhutan as well shares its a lot of border with India. Bhutan is a small country and it's a country wherein there have been a monarchy in the initial years. Just to know where exactly is the location of Bhutan, when we see map of India, this pink color shaded area is Bhutan. So just so that you get a clear idea where exactly Bhutan is in the eastern side of India. So if you see the place, on the map, it becomes better for you to know exactly what you have to understand. So when it comes to Bhutan, politics in Bhutan, the government of Bhutan have been a constitutional monarchy since 2008, and the king of Bhutan is the head of the state. Bhutan has adopted a kind of a codified constitutional monarchy. So they have a multi-party democracy and they have a monarch as well. So it's a kind of a democracy that Bhutan is following. Now that we have studied these seven countries, now for us the next thing that we need to know is India with its neighbors. Now the seven countries that we have done is Pakistan, India, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Bhutan, Maldives and Nepal. So when we talk about India and its neighbors now, The next topic that you need to move on, because India, as I had said in the beginning, is one of the dominant country with physically and even in the population wise, population of India is vast. So India is a dominant country over here in the South Asian region. So we need to know, is India having good relationship? What is the kind of relation that India shares with these neighbors of its? So let's take the very first neighbor of India, that is Bangladesh. The history of Bangladesh, as I told you, as Bangladesh was in fact a part of India initially, then with the division in the year 1947 was divided, then again there were issues between Bangladesh, that is the East Pakistan and the West Pakistan, and at this time Bangladesh again took some help from India, and then again in the year 1971 it got its independence. So India and Bangladesh share a very unique bond, a special relationship because of the common culture, as I have just mentioned that India and Bangladesh both share the common culture, as they were apart, they were one country in fact in the past. So common values, common aspirations. So the issues between the only issues that India and Bangladesh have faced, or India has faced because of Bangladesh, is illegal migration in the year 1971, as we have done earlier, the boundary disputes here and there, and water disputes. Sharing of the river water is also another issue that India and Bangladesh is going through. Let's move on to the next neighbor of India, that is India and Pakistan. As we see India and Pakistan, we are all very familiar with the history of division between India and Pakistan. We know Pakistan was created out of India, or divided, and was created as Pakistan in the year 1947. If I ask you, what is the biggest issue that India and Pakistan have? I am sure the very first thing that will come to your mind is nothing other than Jammu and Kashmir issue. It is one issue since independence is not solved till date, and there have been wars between India and Pakistan several times because of Jammu and Kashmir issue. So India and Pakistan have issues because of Jammu and Kashmir. That's not it. They also have issues over the control of the Siachen glacier. Also issue of sharing of the river water as well, issues of sharing river water between India and Pakistan. So India is having issues between Pakistan of both border disputes, water disputes as well. So it is Jammu and Kashmir, it is the Siachen glacier, and it is the river water sharing. When we talk about India and Nepal, see the amount of Nepal shares the border with India. It shares quite a big amount of border with India, and the relationship between India and Nepal have been very cordial. In fact, the relation has been so special that, you know, it is very important for us to know that you can travel without even a passport to another country, that is Nepal. So good is the relationship between India and Nepal. So India and Nepal have a very good relation wherein the citizens can move on from one country to the other without even a passport. And another thing about Nepal is, ever since India's independence, it has been in good terms. There have been no issues between India and Nepal, other than some trade issues here and there. A few trade issues between India and Nepal. Otherwise, the relationship between India and Nepal have been fairly good and stable till now. The next neighbor, that is Bhutan and Maldives, both have good relationship, cordial relationship with India, and there have been no conflicts between Bhutan and Maldives. As we know, these are very small countries, but we cannot underestimate small countries. These are good countries which have never had any issue with India. When it comes to Maldives, in fact, there were times when Tamils, LTTE, the militant group organization in Sri Lanka, the Liberation Tigers of Tamil Illam, had attacked Maldives, and Maldives had approached Indian government, and Indian government quickly reacted and helped the Maldives at the time of emergency. So Maldives and India also share a very special relation with each other. So the relation between Maldives and Bhutan is quite cordial. So India and Sri Lanka signed a free trade agreement which strengthened the relationship between India and Sri Lanka, because we know we have done Sri Lanka, the ethnic conflict in Sri Lanka, in a few slides before, wherein the relationship between India and Sri Lanka was a bit strained. So there are some agreements which are signed between India and Sri Lanka which are managing the relationship between India and Sri Lanka. Apart from this, India and Sri Lanka have no much issues other than this. Now, as we have come to an end of this lesson, I want you to remember a few points that we have covered. The geography of South Asia in the beginning of the lecture, as I said, the geography, the South Asian countries are, you know, demarcated with natural boundaries of the Himalayas and the ocean. The seven South Asian countries which you need to know, the Pakistan, India, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Nepal, Bhutan and Maldives. The political history, in fact, of these seven countries that we have had political history in the sense whether they have had democracy or whether they have dictatorship. If they have democracy, was it that easy to have democracy? Or if they have dictatorship, was it easy to have dictatorship? So what was the dictatorship favored, in fact? Or people were not happy under, were the people happy under dictatorship? Or people were still demanding for democracy? The struggle that between democracy and dictatorship. Then military and democracy in Pakistan. The next thing that we have done very importantly to focus on military and democracy in Pakistan. The struggle between the military government, that is the democratic form of a government, and the dictatorship form of a government and the democratic form of a government. The next thing is the ethnic conflict in Sri Lanka, a conflict between the Tamils in Sri Lanka and the Sinhalas in Sri Lanka, and constitutional monarchy in Nepal. So these are a few things that you need, and India's relationship with its neighbors. So how, what type of relationship does India hold with its neighbors? Does it hold a cordial relationship with its neighbors, or does it have a stressed relationship with it? Of course, there are issues here and there, but India have tried to stabilize its relationship with the South Asian countries. With this, as we come to an end of this lesson, I would like you all, 12th standard students, 12th standard political science students, in fact, to go to your textbook, read the lesson. This is chapter number 5 from Contemporary World Politics, so that you understand the chapter even better. When you read it by yourself, you will get to know it even more better. So, with this, I end my lecture. Thank you very much.
Prudent Scholars, powered by Lupin Pharmaceuticals.